the meeting now.
Okay, we are back on the record. As I've been trying to keep you updated, court administration has been working hard to try to figure out how to give me more days to this trial. They have a potential solution that would involve next week. I have a docket on Tuesdays in the criminal rotation. We might have a judge available to cover my docket, which would free me up on Tuesday, if the parties are available. And assuming we don't get done today, and I'm anticipating that's the case. So, next Tuesday, Ms. Voss, what is your schedule allow for that? And Mr. Knight?
I have work and I'm missing so much of it. It's just affecting the work right at the moment. I'm not sure what schedules. This is precedent over anything right at the moment, so.
Okay.
I can skip my appointment with Dr. Langer and do this.
Okay, well, we don't know if that's going to happen yet, but okay. I'll let court administration know that it would work on this end if they can find a judge. Okay, well, send out the message and we should find out in a little while. Okay, so let's move on then. Mr. Knight, this is your opportunity to cross-examine Ms. Voss. So you may begin.
Thank you, Your Honor. Ms. Voss, can you tell me where you work at?
SCJ Alliance.
Can you say that again?
SCJ Alliance.
Is that where you've always worked?
No.
Can you tell me where you, the previous employer?
I believe this has been asked and answered in my initial testimony.
I have never crossed you, or I've never...
Yeah, so it's going to be on, so it may have been come up someplace else, but he still is able
okay.
to ask questions.
Okay. No, I've not always worked for SCJ.
Could you explain, you've explained this before.
Yes.
Correct. Do you work for, did you work for Glander and Associates prior? Or is that the correct name?
Jeff Glander and Associates, yes.
Okay. And you're a landscape designer?
Yes.
And do you have the ability to become an architect?
An architect?
Yeah, can you take it one step? Do you have the ability to take it one step further?
Do you mean a landscape architect?
Landscape architect, yes, thank you.
Do I have the ability to, I currently don't have the resources.
I didn't ask, that's not the question. Do you have the ability to do that?
Well, the ability would have implied the resources, but that would be, yes, a career path option available.
Are you proud of your work?
I am.
Isn't it true that you did a award-winning reclamation park in Yelm.
Yes.
And you've done some very nice projects all around Washington.
Yes.
Can you explain to me, since I get, not explain, relevance. Sorry.
Okay, so the question is relevance.
Okay. Relevance? Relevance is, she had testified that she is a landscape architect and that she has done things. And I'm trying to put basis down for her job. And Dr. Langer even spoke about how her ability to do all the paperwork is such a great thing for her job. So it's already been spoke about how they tie together. So I'm trying to relate and ask questions about her job and her projects to show that she is very smart and has higher capabilities.
I'll give you latitude. You can ask questions. But it's
answer.
Limited latitude.
There were a number of misrepresentations in that explanation that are not relevant.
And he's just explaining why it's relevant. Remember the whole scintilla evidence? And so we're on the scintilla world. So
you have a lot of projects in the Western Washington area.
Around the western part of our country, yes.
Oh, western. So you do very large projects.
Yes.
Okay, great. Do you feel that Hayden and Chloe are proud of your abilities to do these projects?
Yes.
Are you proud of your abilities to do these projects?
Objection again, relevance.
Okay, but I want to know what the relevance is of her feeling proud about her projects.
Because it sets her state of mind on atmosphere of things going on. If she's not going to be proud of her own things, then she's not going to be proud of anything else that anybody does.
Sustained. Move on to some other project. Other line of question.
All right. Let's go back to this one here. Let's start back here. Let's go to 62A. Ms. Voss, do you recognize this exhibit?
I do.
Is this the exhibit you just testified to recently?
Yes.
And this is an exhibit of pictures from of Hayden's esophagus through different endoscopies throughout the years, but not all of them, correct?
Correct.
So this is depicting an esophagus that is undamaged.
I'm sorry, but which portion of this exhibit are we looking at?
I'm looking at the top page, first page.
Top.
These four here.
Okay, thank you.
The top four are esophagus, yes.
Yes, and they're dated 1/11/13, correct?
That appears to be the case, yes.
So Hayden was approximately 7?
I think.
6, 7, okay. So, going to the third page, we have pictures of the esophagus from 10/14/21, correct?
At the bottom are esophagus and one above are, yes. I'm sorry, let me check the date. 10/14/21, yes.
Okay, so the bottom four are esophagus from...
Yes, I believe so.
I couldn't hear that. The bottom four are what?
Are from the esophagus. These are different parts of
the
anatomy.
I'm with you.
Okay, so So this is obvious that to you and to myself from the from speaking with the doctors that there is a problem going on. Is this correct?
Yes.
Okay. Did Dr. Abdullah prescribe Flovent for this occasion?
Dr. Abdullah prescribed Flovent. And I'd have to refresh my memory as to the date. This was dated October of 21. And I would have to look at his records to be certain.
Okay. Next question. Was Hayden prescribed Flovent on November 3rd of 2021?
Again, I'd have to check. Refresh my memory as to date.
November 3rd at Hayden's appointment with Dr. Abdullah. It was the these are the pictures of the endoscopy of that occurred on 10/20. Hold on, is there two different ones? No, 10/22/20.
Birthday.
Hold on, wait a minute. I was looking at the wrong picture. I'm still talking about the one on 21, not 22, not 20. 2014. 2021. So, isn't it true that there's been documentation filed that Hayden was prescribed Flovent on November 3rd by Dr. Abdullah from the results of the labs from this scope?
Again, I don't recall the exact date that he prescribed it. Would need to refresh my memory.
Okay, I'll have to find that for you. For sake of speediness, I'm going to come back to this later.
Okay. And if you could just place the actual original exhibits when you're not using them in a spot so they don't get mixed up with other documents, that way we'll don't have to keep on getting up and giving it back.
I will. And there is my post-it note to myself to discuss this with Mr. Knight still on the exhibit. Is it okay if I remove my post-it?
You could take that post-it off.
Thank you.
Go ahead, Mr. Knight.
Okay. Ms. Voss, do you recall Dr. Abdullah saying in his testimony that Flovent had been prescribed but was not being followed by one, but not being applied by one parent?
That is not my recollection of his testimony.
Do you recall that Dr. Abdullah said that he had prescribed Flovent for Hayden?
I believe he testified that he prescribed it, yes.
Okay. What are your feelings? Hold on, let me rephrase that. Was Flovent a medication previously used while Hayden was a toddler.
The medication was used in two different ways, so I guess yes.
Is Flovent used in two separate ways at the time for two separate reasons?
Yes.
Was one of the reasons because it was an inhaled Flovent for a treatment of asthma for Hayden?
Yes.
And it was also a swallowed treatment for the treatment of eosinophilic esophagitis at the same time, correct?
At very different dosages, yes.
At very different dosages, but it was basically prescribed twice for him at that when he, as a toddler.
Correct.
Isn't it true that Hayden also had to use budesonide for asthma on through an nebulizer for a long time?
Yes.
And isn't that also a corticosteroid?
It is.
So there's, do you recall that all of these steroids were being used at the same time?
No. Always. Never budesonide at the same time as inhaled Flovent. There were times when there was both swallowed and inhaled Flovent. There were times when there was inhaled budesonide and possibly swallowed Flovent, but not all at the same time.
Isn't it true that the insurance at one time decided Flovent wasn't going to be covered for whatever their reasons were?
I can't be certain. I know you reported that.
Okay. Isn't it true that the state DSHS Apple Insurance has a ability to change what they're going to pay for through the prescription process?
I believe so, but again, I'm speculating as to, I don't know a lot about that.
Okay. Would it be stand a reason that the state may decide that for economic reasons or whatever reasons they, medical reasons, they decide not to cover a medicine and choose to cover, pay for a different medicine to cover the same kind of symptoms?
Are you asking hypothetically or do I know for certain?
I'm asking hypothetically because we're laymen, we can't come for certain.
Right. It's my understanding that at times, I've heard people report that one medication is not covered, and so the state will only pay for another medication. Is that what you're looking for there?
Yeah, that's fine. So you agree that the state has a high control over medications that they pay for?
And in referring to the state, you're talking about Molina or Apple Health?
Yes, that's what I, how, when I'm referring to the state, referring to the insurance, I'm meaning DSHS assistant help that we have for the children
and
through the Molina.
Repeat your question.
Isn't it true that they have a high control over all medications that are being prescribed?
All medications might be in a reach. I can't.
That they will be
that.
Paying for.
I think they have a great deal of authority in what they choose to pay for and what they don't choose to pay for.
Okay. So when it comes to medications being prescribed and chosen, that's done by a medical physician, correct? Not Mr. Knight?
I'm sorry. Can you repeat your question?
When a medicine is prescribed to a patient, Let's say Hayden. That's the doctor's and Molina's and the pharmacist's authorities to do that, not Mr. Knight's. Isn't that correct?
No.
Okay. Does Mr. Knight have any kind of MD degree?
No.
So Mr. Knight couldn't prescribe any kind of Flovent for Hayden?
Correct.
So that's a... something that was done by his GI doctor, Dr. Abdullah, correct?
Did Dr. Abdullah prescribe Flovent? Is that what you're getting at?
Yes. Did Dr. Abdullah prescribe Flovent?
Yes, he did.
Okay. Did you administer the Flovent after you were informed that it was needed for Hayden's flaring EOE?
Did I administer it? No.
Yes. Have you administered it all since it was prescribed on November 3rd?
It's not prescribed to me. So no, I have not administered it.
Okay. Have you administered the medication to Hayden that it had was prescribed to for his EOE to heal so that he can go to the next scope and find out if it is working?
Have I administered his medication to him? No, I have not.
Have you provided the medication to him?
Yes.
Did you tell him why he should not take that medication?
No.
Do you speak to Hayden about his medications?
Yes.
Do you tell Hayden your fears about medications?
I.
It's a yes or no question.
And it's not as simple as your question.
Do you speak with Hayden about your concerns about medications?
I do. We look at the
no inserts. Further.
We look at the
excuse inserts. Me, sir. That was a yes or no.
And we discuss.
Wait, hold on. I'm going to allow a little latitude in that answer. I don't think it is entirely a yes or no, because you said, well, it depends on. I can understand why it would not be yes or no because of the language used. So you can answer the question.
Thank you. Whenever the children are prescribed medication, we talk about what the package insert from the pharmacy says, what are the possible side effects, what are concerns. We discuss history, if relevant, if they've taken it before, how to use it, what time of day. With swallowed Flovent specifically, there's specific instructions on how to take it. So there are concerns embedded in that. Here's a medication. We don't put things into our body without knowing what it can or cannot do or what to watch out for. So there are concerns that I do articulate, but not in the manner was suggesting.
Okay. Do you believe Hayden should be taking Flovent?
No.
Did you tell Hayden that he should not be taking Flovent?
No.
Did you imply that Hayden should not take him Flovent?
No.
Then why is Hayden not taking the Flovent at your house?
Hayden remembers what happened when he was on steroids in the past, and he has stated emphatically that he does not want to feel that way again. And so I've told him that it is his choice whether to take this or not, based on his ability to make decisions about his mental health and the history with this particular medication causing mood and behavioral disturbances in the past that he remembers, and suicidal ideation in the past that he remembers. That's his decision, whether or not he wants to go through that again. That's his decision.
Do you explain this to providers in front of Hayden? This type of thing, of your concerns of Flovent?
First, I don't have an opportunity to talk to providers with Hayden. So, no?
Okay, let me rephrase that. When you are discussing with a friend or acquaintance, whoever, your issues around Mr. Knight, is the children around?
Objection. There's no foundation for the assumption embedded in that question.
There is a foundational question that wasn't asked about
a long time
ago there. So I'm going to sustain because there's an assumption in that question.
Okay.
Foundation has to be laid.
Do you speak to people about your concerns of Mr. Knight?
Yes.
Are the children present when you are doing so?
Sometimes yes, sometimes no.
So could it be assumed that you have talked about your concerns of Flovent to people and Hayden could have possibly overheard it? Heard it?
When the children are present, I am mindful of their presence and speak about these things in what I feel are appropriate and respectful terms.
Okay. So you like to you talk very a lot with Hayden, right? You explain a lot of stuff, and you're very empathetic with him. So wouldn't it be reasonable to think that you have sat down and had a long conversation with Hayden about what had happened to him when he was a toddler on Flovent years ago?
Can you restate the question?
Okay. Isn't it possible, or would it be okay for me to presume that since you are so involved in Hayden's life that you have sat down with Hayden and talked to him intensively about what had occurred with the Flovent in the past?
No.
You haven't done that?
I have not done what you described.
Okay. No. So how did the conversation come around about how Hayden felt previous, telling you that he didn't want to feel that way and he remembered how bad he was? How did that conversation occur?
I asked him if he remembered taking it before.
And that was after it was prescribed, correct?
No, it was long before.
Oh. So you have led him to think that he has had this problem before.
That's not what I said.
Wouldn't it be reasonable to think that having a conversation with a adolescent, that they'd be led, pretty easily led by their parent?
You're making some assumptions there.
Did you not say that you have a lot more connection and influence over the children than Mr. Knight?
I didn't say influence.
You didn't say influence? Okay. Yeah. I retract the influence, I guess. Isn't it true that you've implied that the children
objection.
Listen to you more than they listen to Mr. Knight?
What's your objection? The question again, please.
So, isn't it true You've stated that you have more influence with the children than Mr. Knight.
Objection. Asked and answered. We already did the influence.
That's the first part of the question. Let's get to the end of the question first. And
okay.
You did ask about whether she had more influence.
Right.
She answered that one.
Okay. Did you not testify that the children listen to you better and tell you everything?
That's not my testimony, no.
Okay. So, let me go through these a little bit. Mediation. I'd like to discuss 321D.
Did you say B or D?
D.
As in dog?
As in dog.
This is B.
That's B.
As in boy.
Okay. Is that one not admitted?
321D is admitted.
Okay.
But Ms. Boss hasn't provided the original yet.
Okay. And okay. So it's inside of 321.
321E?
No, just a general.
Oh, in the 321.
Because it hasn't been split out.
Okay. Okay, yeah, because there's two subjects here I wanted to talk about anyway. So I'd like 321A, E, and D.
So E is the one from today.
You do not have D. Can we proceed with D? Do you have a copy of D, Ms. Voss?
Just a moment.
Probably somewhere.
Are you looking for 321D?
D.
Okay. So, we had this discussion earlier today as we were trying to come up with what the 321D was, and I explained that it is, at the bottom it says Exhibit 109, page 3 of 16, and it goes through Exhibit 116, page 6 of 8.
Could I get 116 also?
So what it is it's in the main 321.
Okay.
So that's what we'll need to use because
okay.
We don't have the split off 321D.
Okay, and 321 also broke down into 116, right? Isn't there a 116 broke out in one of these two? Because didn't you say this was referred to back in?
Well, yeah, but I'm just talking about what was written at the very bottom.
That doesn't
mean anything more than what was on the document.
Oh, okay, so it does have it. Okay.
Yeah,
sorry.
I
you have 321. Okay, so let's pull 321.
25 pages in is where you're going to end up on D, and the email of the Our Family Wizard is dated September 17, 2018 at the top from Mr. Knight.
And there's another one dated 11/27/19 according to my notes.
Yes.
Not in this group, and that might have been something I said earlier today because I was trying to find it.
Oh, that's not in that group.
So. But if you get to the Our Family Wizard that at the top, it has message 1 of 1, 9/17/28 from Mr. Knight, about 25 pages into the document.
Okay, and I'm sorry, I'm both trying to respond to Mr. Knight's questions and keep track of what I'm preparing this evening.
I don't think he's asked a question yet. I think
okay,
he's turning to
okay.
321D right now.
Right, and my understanding is that it contains two different...
It's the email. I'm only looking for the page one email request of mediation on 9/17/18.
Okay, thank you.
I think she's on that page.
I am.
You are on that page. Okay. So, can we just identify the date, or can you identify the date, please?
9/17/18.
Okay.
I'm sorry, that's the response date. There's, it's a chain.
Okay.
That has an original entry on 9/16/18.
And who was that entry from?
The initial was from me.
Okay.
And the follow-up response was from you.
Okay. So on this date here, was this? This was before you had testified that you knew that Mr. Knight's brother had committed suicide, correct?
Correct.
Is this before the date of Mr. Knight's brother's committing suicide?
I believe so, yes.
Okay. And you were asking for mediation at this time?
Yes.
Okay. So, the exhibit. So, you testified to an email that has been admitted about a family wizard email of concerning a meeting, a family meeting between Mr. Knight, Miss Voss, and Miss Knight, and the children on 10/4/18, correct?
Correct.
And that has been admitted. I'm not exactly sure which exhibit that is, but you have provided testimony on that?
Yes.
Okay. Were we discussing mediation at that time?
No, it was off the table. At the time of the meeting, you were still opposed to mediation.
But Kim and I, isn't it true that Kim and I had agreed to have this meeting with you that day?
Yes.
Was it under the assumption that we were attempting to make some sort of agreement for the betterment of the children's situation and ours?
Yes.
Did it feel like we were making progress on that day?
That's hard to answer. Was it my impression that we were making progress? It was my hope that we were making progress. It was my impression that you were grandstanding in front of your wife.
Isn't it true that I've always told you that I didn't want you in my home anymore?
No.
On more than one occasion, I told you to stay away from my house. I didn't want you around it.
On more than one occasion, yes.
Okay. So, couldn't it be assumed that Mrs. Knight at that time talked Mr. Knight into trying to settle the issues?
Yes.
Do you think by having a third party involved on that, that it actually made it go forward a little bit?
I think Kim was a positive influence, yes.
Do we not have the WISE team in between us at this moment?
In between us.
Is it not true that the information transfers between WISE team, with the WISE team from my home to your home, of what's going on to keep things stable? Has it not been utilized
wait
in that fashion?
Wait a second. Get done with the question. Let's wait for the answer.
I'm not sure that sentence was in the form of a question.
Isn't it true? I think it is.
Isn't it true that there... can you please restate the question?
I'm not sure if I can hit it exactly right, but the essence of it is we have been using it in that manner, have we not?
Again, I'm not understanding your question. Using it in
okay,
what manner?
Okay, let me see if I can. Do you feel you are getting more information about the children's care and stuff at my home through the information you are receiving from WISE?
No.
Do you feel you're getting more than you would have if you just didn't have have them there?
It's really hard to answer. If I could explain.
No. Do you feel Mr. Knight will give you the information that you request and on your demand?
No.
Okay. Do you feel like you could get the information through a third party quicker than you could through Mr. Knight?
It really depends.
Is it Mr. Knight's responsibility on the parenting plan to give you all information that you request?
No.
Isn't it true that you have been trying to force Mr. Knight to give you all information that you request? Isn't it true that we've been in litigation for 2 years with Ms. Voss asking all sorts of questions and asking for all sorts of information from Mr. Knight?
Objection, compound question.
Question within that question, so if you can break that out to two questions.
Is it true that we have been litigating this case for 2 years, or a little over 2 years?
And again, how we define this case is...
Okay. The case of 20-3-00178-23, has it not been going on for approximately 2 years?
No.
No. How many years do you think it has been going on?
I think on September 2nd, it will be 2 years. I think we're a ways from September. A year and a half?
Mm-hmm.
Am I missing something in the math there?
No, I guess I was rounding up.
Remember, you don't ask the questions, he asks, you answer, you keep on going.
Okay, so we have been in this for a very long time again. Do you think that is the timeline has something to do with the pandemic outbreak of slowing down how long this process took to get to trial?
I don't see a correlation there, no. I think we've done this several times in 17, 18, 24 months is par for the course, as I recall.
So you don't think the pandemic slowed down our case during the last 2 years or during the pandemic? You don't think it has slowed down the process of us getting from point A to point B, the ending, at all?
I'm not aware of any COVID-related issues in filing or setting hearings or serving, aside from a very brief window of time where I had COVID-like symptoms and had to have another party, but still that didn't slow anything. It was just more inconvenient.
Okay. Was there not a shutdown? Was there not a pandemic shutdown?
Yeah.
So would that affect how long this occurred?
I don't see a correlation, no.
Okay.
I don't see a causation.
Okay. Next question. Miss Voss, you testified about a date. Let me see. Is this the one here? So, when Mr. Knight took Hayden and Chloe to a walk-in clinic to get school documentation for them to start, and you just happen to have all of your paperwork in the car that you thought a provider may need. And your testimony is that you just happened to make a guess that Mr. Knight was going to be at a walk-in clinic. Miraculously, you walk in and you have all the paperwork in your hand. Tell me again, how did that happen?
I'm sorry, I have to object to the assertion that I've said all these things and that improperly characterizing my prior testimony in his question.
You can answer the question, though. He was laying his foundation for his question. You may not agree with it, but you can certainly answer the question.
So, first, I didn't say what you just described. If you're asking, as I testified previously, I knew you had not taken the children to a doctor. You hadn't found a new allergist all summer. And you were predictably waiting for the last minute to find a provider who had no prior knowledge of the children's medical history, who would be likely rushed to just write down whatever you said for school plans without medical records. I know your behavior well enough to be able to predict that you would choose the most convenient, overworked, unknowledgeable provider to achieve your aim, which was the most convenient option rather than the most appropriate option or the option ordered by the court. So I concluded that you most likely went to the nearest walk-in clinic And I, because I was waiting all summer for you to go to a doctor, I had the paperwork ready. I didn't. So when you picked up the children and informed me, you had to take them to an appointment that you didn't tell me about, it was pretty reasonable for me to conclude that it was a walk-in clinic, and it wasn't hard for me to grab my papers, get in the car, and go right to that clinic. I think I could maintain visual contact for a brief bit, but yeah, no, your behavior is rather predictable.
Does the parenting plan state that you are allowed to attend doctor's appointments?
The parenting plan does not prohibit me from attending appointments.
Does it prohibit you from attending doctor's appointments with the children?
It does.
It does.
Would you call that a doctor's appointment with the children?
I was not attending with.
Did you not children. Arrive?
Being in the building doesn't mean I'm attending the appointment.
So, you've been testifying about Hayden's cell phone. How
I
Mr.
Have.
Knight won't let Hayden have his cell phone.
I have. Mm-hmm.
So, did you buy Hayden a cell phone?
I did.
And when did you buy Hayden a cell phone?
Before he started middle school.
Before he started middle school?
Yes.
So, was that about 2019?
I believe so.
It was. Amazing.
So, Mr. Knight.
Sorry.
You ask questions, you don't comment on them.
Okay. So, you purchased a cell phone for Hayden in 2019. Is that what I just heard you say?
It was before he started middle school, and I believe that was 2019, yes.
Did you install the parental tracking on Hayden's phone because of you have the capability of doing so?
I didn't install, but we both downloaded the Life 360 app so that we could find his phone when it was lost.
No.
And I can find my phone when it is lost, and we help each other find each other's phones, yes.
So, do you have 321E in front of you?
I do.
You do? Okay. Can you go to the email on page 2?
Which?
The
segment?
Bottom one.
The initial on 9519?
9519. At 11:13.
Yes.
Okay. Can you read that for me?
I think the document speaks. I'm sorry, objection. I think I'll read it. Withdraw. I found the phone you gave to Hayden to keep in his backpack. I turned off the location. I see how you know I was at the clinic. I got Hayden and Chloe's school emergence med forms and meds in place with the school nurse. I have set a well child appointment with Oakland Bay Pediatrics, 247 Professional Way, Shelton, Washington, 98584, telephone number. Hayden has his appointment 10/2/19 at 9 a.m. Chloe's appointment is 9/30/19 at 9:30 a.m. Stephanie Terry informed me she will send you a copy of the forms.
Okay, thank you. So isn't it true that the previous pediatrician had, at Healthy Future Pediatrics, had terminated care for Hayden and Chloe previous to this date?
Yes.
Isn't it true that Mr. Knight was setting up a new pediatrician on this date?
You claim to be, yes.
Isn't it true that Hayden and Chloe did attend Oakland Bay Pediatrics until it became Mason Clinic?
Yes.
And is continuing to today?
Yes.
So, isn't it true that Mr. Knight found a new pediatrician or a new doctor for the children after the previous pediatrician from Healthy Future Pediatrics terminated care?
Yes.
Okay. Isn't it true here that it appears that Mr. Knight may have been tracked into the clinic by Hayden's phone?
It's true that you believed that was the case.
Did you notify Mr. Knight that you had purchased a cell phone for Hayden?
No.
Did you have Hayden inform Mr. Knight that he had a cell phone?
No.
Did Mr. Knight have any indication that Hayden had a cell phone on his person?
I don't know.
Okay. No further questions on that document. These are mine. Could I get respondents exhibit 9049 or exhibit 109?
This same document has already been admitted as a different exhibit.
I was wondering the same thing.
It has. It's just where I can find it. I was just going to discuss it.
Okay.
But does it have to be the one that has been admitted?
It is. And the reason we do that is so that the record's clear.
Okay.
What is being discussed. If we don't track it that way, then it sounds like a totally different document.
Okay.
Ms. Voss,
I have the cross-reference table here, yes.
The comparison notes can tell us where to find it.
So remind me, that's Seattle Children's Hospital.
That's Seattle Children's.
And not cardiology, it is mental health.
Basically, it is just a portion of this document.
Yes.
Of two separate different documents.
Yes.
Or not exactly the same, but I think this is the second time a year.
So the emergency department records are 53. I believe it's been admitted as 53.
two pages of this exhibit.
So is it from 2019?
It is from October 11th, 2019 and 1913.
Yep.
Ms. Voss, you previously testified that this is a document that it came from Seattle Children's while you took Chloe up to Seattle Children's because for treatment for a suicidal threat. Is that correct?
Not for treatment, but for emergency evaluation and crisis services, yes.
Okay. And in the process of this, there has been a crisis prevention plan filled out, correct?
Yes.
So in this prevention plan, it states triggers. Is this correct?
Yes.
Okay. How does a child or a person decide what a trigger is?
In this instance, there were several steps to the emergency department visit. There was triage. There was a physical examination by another provider. There was kind of a brief summary, kind of where both Rice and I were present and kind of described the problems and issues. There was, I'd have to read the document to recall all the different providers that provided different evaluations, some with both Rice and I together, some with me separately, some with Rice separately, and so they explained the idea, I believe, I can't remember if it was this visit or the other visit, they even drew a diagram on a whiteboard of a buildup of frustration and crisis and de-escalation cycle. There was a little bit of education provided to both of us, and so in their description, they were trying to get us all on the same page in terms of terminology in what is a trigger, and so asking me separately stuff, and this crisis prevention plan was actually produced strictly on the interview portion with Rice.
Okay. So these came from Rice?
Yes.
You had no influence over them?
No.
Okay. Can...
Actually, I take that back. So they filled out a card, and I don't know if we have, the card here.
Here, what, hold on.
I'm
here.
Sorry.
I'm out, that's outside of what I'm talking about.
I'm trying to explain, and I'd like to not provide misleading testimony, so can I refresh my memory?
I'm questioning on what I would like to be Exhibit 109, if it's inside. Is that whole file been? Obviously, it's been in there.
This file was admitted, I believe.
Yeah.
In.
And what is that one again? I guess I'll have to pull it out to.
Number 53.
153.
No, not 153.
Just
53.
Just
4. We can see the coping card that Rice filled out initially. And there's two different handwritings. I'm not sure if it's clear to everyone else, but the first two triggers, bullies and dad, were all that Rice could come up with on their own. And so the other handwriting, so yeah, this obviously contradicts my prior recollection, and glad I looked, that Rice was asked to fill out more of this. And then the provider left the room, and Rice only came up with two. And so I was trying to elicit more information so that we could come up with a meaningful coping card. And so this information was provided by Rice, who was too frustrated to write at that point. And so I filled it out. The provider then took out what was filled out and verified things independently with Rice, and then they entered what you see on the first page of the crisis prevention plan.
Okay.
After discussing that with Rice independently. I was really impressed with how they siloed out things.
So, let me hear, am I hearing you right? You discussed with Rice what the, what she wanted to put on this paper, so you
yes.
had influence on what went on this paper.
I asked questions.
Okay. How does one, do you have, oh, hold on, I'm going to phrase it. What makes a trigger? What is a trigger? What psychologically do you understand what is a trigger?
Are you asking? Well, I can tell you what they described to us as they drew it on the board, and things that irritate us, that get us stressed or anxious or whatever, they trigger an escalation of feelings, I guess. For example, putting a burr under a saddle would irritate a horse. That would be a trigger for.
So a trigger is usually an irritation, the personal irritation.
Again, this is, I'm not a psychologist. It could be something that triggers a happy memory, music. In my general understanding of the word trigger, a song can make me smile. So things trigger.
Okay. Do you think if a child is seeing negativity about from one parent to the other parent, that they may internalize it?
I think it can be internalized, yes. It's possible.
Do you think that if a child loves two people equally and they are arguing, that that would cause frustration and irritation?
I'm never going to get over the word frustration. Can you repeat the question there? I'm sorry. I got triggered.
So if a child loves two parents and the parents are arguing and stuff, does that not cause conflict in the child?
It certainly can.
Okay. Could it cause the child to develop triggers?
Again.
In your understanding, would it be possible that a trigger could be developed out of the misunderstanding of a child between two parents?
Again, your use of the word trigger is, if you're asking that conflict between parents can impact a child, absolutely, yes. But I'm not understanding the use of the word trigger in that sentence.
Do you feel that a conflict can cause a child to feel that their father is a trigger?
I suppose if a child observes both parents or is aware of the parental conflict, the conflict can trigger feelings in the child. The child's feelings about the parent, if the parent is perceived by the child as causing or contributing to that conflict more than the other, if that child perceives one parent is acting differently than the other, then that problematic parent could be identified as a problem. But again, the word triggering. In this instance, are you driving at my explaining dad as a trigger? Maybe. I think that might be easier.
No, I'm not trying to get you to explain why you think dad's a trigger. I'm trying to figure out how we would even get there.
Okay. I don't know if I answered your question.
Well, you answered enough of them. And again, if you can go into the same exhibit, into the same, on August 16th, 2020, it's basically the same exact thing with a little bit of difference. August
16th,
2020.
And the page number on that is?
It is 24 of 38. Okay. So isn't this one here similar in how it was filled out?
Yeah.
Isn't it true that you took Rice, Chloe / Rice, to this emergency appointment? It would be an appointment. An emergency action that you took to take the child all the way to Seattle Children's on August 16th, instead of going to locally to Mason Clinic or any other clinic, you chose to, on August 16th, to drive all the way to Seattle. Is this not true?
As previously testified, I brought Rice to Seattle Children's on these dates. Yes.
Okay. Why did you not stop at St. Peter's in Lacey?
Because they do not have a pediatric psych unit anymore. They used to, but they don't do that anymore. So,
are you sure your information is up to date?
At the time, I called them, and I was told that they don't do that. I called the other clinic that I'd heard was opening in Lacey in the Woodland Square area, and they also did not have a pediatric psychologist. And I called multiple providers. I also talked to the sheriff's department, who suggested that agreed that Seattle Children's would be the best place. Previously, we had gone to Mason General in the past, and that did not, again, they were not a pediatric psych specialist. And in this instance, a pediatric psych eval seemed appropriate.
So in a case, in an emergency situation where you have the right to take the children to the doctor for their safety, wouldn't it have been prudent to go to the nearest medical provider and that allow them to decide
instead of you deciding to go all the way to Seattle and have a pediatric person in Seattle do this?
Because there was no imminent threat to their person. They weren't, well, I called the police when Bryce was, you know, I called 911 during the incident, which I haven't even testified to, but I called 911 during the incident, and the Mason County Sheriff came out, and we discussed where would be the best place. And so, based on that information, that conversation, that guidance, and it was agreed that Seattle Children's would be the best place. So if you're asking me if I shouldn't have gone to the most convenient location instead of the most appropriate location, I felt that the quality was more important than the inconvenience of the long drive.
Okay. So you stated, I just heard you state that it was not life-threatening, it wasn't imminent. It was not imminent danger. Is that the wording you just used?
They had put down the knives. They had put down the scissors. But without prompt treatment, I had no reason to believe that they wouldn't pick one up again. And so maintaining constant communication, going and getting some food on our way to Seattle.
Hold on, I just asked you, did you not use the word, no, they were not in imminent danger? Did you not just say that?
I did.
You did. So if she was not in imminent danger, where does the emergency come in?
As I just tried
to... No, you just stated it was not in imminent danger.
Okay, let's pause for a moment. We're getting back to an argument right now. Okay, so, and I don't want to stop your line of questions, Mr. Knight. So go ahead and start that back up again. And when I hear a partial response and a no, and then go like that, that is a discussion going on.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's difficult. I understand that. Let's try to keep it from question answer.
Okay. Isn't an emergency when somebody is in imminent danger? Is that not considered an emergency?
I think it's a fairly nebulous term. I have been struggling.
Emergencies are when people are in immediate danger, life-threatening danger. You just said that her life was not in danger. It was not in imminent danger.
Objection, Your Honor. He's not allowing me to answer my question.
You have several questions going on, Mr. Knight.
Okay, I'm sorry.
We need to stop after a question, allow an answer, and then go to the next question. But you're asking a question on top of a question before she answers.
Okay.
And I think you're rephrasing it in some respects.
It's trying to be the same question.
I understand. Okay, I think you might have an answer. Would you please answer?
Thank you, Your Honor. I have been grappling with the definition of imminent threat, imminent danger, emergency. In my understanding, if you see a freight train headed towards a bridge that has collapsed and there's no deviation from this course, at what point is this an emergency? I don't know the answer to that. And so in this instant, I believed that if there was not prompt intervention, harm would result. And so I felt it was an emergency that our child received prompt evaluation, a crisis plan, and I needed instruction on how to deal with this situation.
Wasn't it not true that at the time, Chloe was attending counseling at Consejo Counseling?
Yes.
Did you try to contact Consejo Counseling?
Absolutely. Many times. and the school and you. And that's why I went to Seattle Children's.
Did you not, did I respond to you on text?
Not until after I told you about, and I'm sorry, I'm going to need the actual text to refresh my memory, but you did not respond to my many, many questions prior to my seeing Rice pick up a knife and threaten to hurt themselves.
Ms. Voss, did you send any questions to Mr. Knight on August 16th, 2020 about Rice hurting herself?
As I recall, I called.
Did you send any questions to Mr. Knight on August 16th, 2020?
Refresh my memory.
That is the day that you were rushing Chloe to Seattle Children's. On that day, did you ask any questions of Mr. Knight concerning Chloe's suicide threats?
As I tried to say earlier, I called you. I believe, and I'd like my memory to be refreshed, I believe we had some text communication. I believe there's an exhibit here somewhere about a text, but I don't want to testify as to what date, what time, what I said without seeing it, so I can't recall specifically.
So from this appointment that you took Chloe on August 16th, 2020, was there
again,
a...
Again, objection. The characterization of this as an appointment is embedded in the question is a misleading statement. An emergency room visit is not an appointment. You don't call.
Okay, so I can understand right now that you're not going to call an appointment and you are going to call an appointment. So if we can just ask something that doesn't utilize the word appointment, we won't have this problem, but you can still describe it.
Did you take Chloe to Seattle Children's on this day?
Yes, it answered.
Okay. Did they provide you with a finding on that day?
A finding?
Or
we've got
a result from the visit?
Yes, we've got this documentation in my hand.
Okay.
And the record should reflect that you're referencing Exhibit 53.
Thank you.
Okay. So, in this exhibit, does it state that Chloe is showing signs of depression?
Can you point me to specifically
I simply asked, does it state that in there?
And I don't recall specifically.
So, can you explain to me what date the diagnosis for ADHD and autism was brought forth for Chloe?
There was no actual diagnosis. I do recall reading an erroneous entry in this record where I recall informing the provider that that Rice's therapist suspected ADHD and that the school performed some testing suggesting they have the same qualities or characteristics of a child with ADHD, autism. And how, you know, did I speak inartfully? Did someone misinterpret what I was saying? I can't explain how the record doesn't reflect what exactly I said.
Can it be said that you have a lot to say about the children's health?
In what sense? I'm not understanding.
In absolutely every sense. You have a lot to say about everything, yes.
Do I
in
have
general
opinions?
Yes.
Do I have opinions? Yes, I have opinions.
Okay. So So can you understand how your opinions and the way you project your opinions, people may misinterpret your meanings and think that you are making diagnoses or have these are diagnoses?
Sustained speculation.
So, can you tell me which therapist suggested that Chloe may have ADHD?
That was Draven Alexander Lane at the time.
Okay. Does Draven have a psychology PhD?
I can't recall exactly which credentials she's seeking right now. I believe she's almost reached her PhD at this point.
Isn't it true that in 2019-20, she was saying she had almost reached her PhD at that time?
No, that's not my recollection.
Okay. So, a person without the proper degree made a suggestion that Chloe may have signs of ADHD, and it gets put into a emergency suicide visit at Seattle Children's. Is that correct?
The first part of your statement is not correct. As I recall, and the record, I believe, will reflect that Draven stated to both of us that they saw signs of ADHD in both children, and there was a recommendation that you take the children to Mason General for a neuropsych eval to find out, you know, what was actually going on there.
So was this suggestion brought forth to Mr. Knight, or was this during your conversations with Miss Alexander or Alexander?
Robin, the record notes, obviously I wasn't there when Draven talked to you, but the record reflects that Draven spoke to both parents. I recall us having a conversation, and as I recall, they indicated they either had or were going to talk to you.
Did Draven Alexander ever inform you that she has Asperger's?
Again, I have to object to the pronoun in your statement, but no, I don't recall hearing that.
You don't ever recall her stating to you, because she stated it to everybody, that she has Asperger's?
That is not my recollection. Again, please pronounce.
Okay, I would like exhibit 110. Thank you.
Okay.
you identify what this is?
This appears to be a text message chain between myself and you.
Do you recall this text message chain?
Yes.
Is this the text message chain that you were just asking for so you could testify?
Yes.
Can we have this exhibit admitted?
Any objections to Exhibit 110?
No objections.
Exhibit 110 is admitted.
So in this exhibit here, after you ran off, took Chloe up and had a visit and took care of your anxieties.
Objection.
Sorry.
Mr. Knight, whatever question you were going to ask after that, she was going to object to because it's your characterization of her actions.
Okay.
Which was inappropriate.
So okay, sorry. I apologize. Okay, in this email, or this text chain here, on the third page, doesn't it state that I'm attempting to make an agreement with you on for the return of Chloe so that it did not interfere with your return home and cause any more issues?
I'm sorry. Can you direct me to what you're talking about?
Yeah, it's right above the time for 8:43, right above it, where it says you are going to get home late. Starts that way.
And repeat your question.
Wasn't this an attempt by me to try to make an accommodation for you because it was going to be so late?
That was not how I interpreted your statement or your gesture. It was 9:21 p.m. and we were still at the emergency department, it looks like, at 9:21 p.m. So to infer you were trying to make things easier on me, I think is a mischaracterization.
You think so? Wasn't Chloe supposed to have transferred on that day to me?
I can't recall specifically, but given the context, it appears that there would have been an exchange.
So, okay. So you don't see that as a way of trying to work together?
I can understand how you might feel that way, but no, that is not how I interpreted this.
Do you interpret a lot of things that Mr. Knight's doing as being against you? Or only for his interest?
When you told me that you had previously been described as the laziest and most selfish person this person had ever met.
Objection, Your Honor. Hearsay.
I think she said when you told her, so that would not be hearsay. That would be an exception to hearsay.
Still, yeah, I never told her that.
You will have an opportunity to provide your own testimony. I'm gonna allow the answer. I was was an objection, I was going to say non-responsive, but I think you might end up being responsive, so go ahead.
And through this, I've sort of lost the question. I recall the first part of my answer, but I believe, can you restate the question?
It related to her interpretation of the things that you...
Yeah, the interpretations of my intent.
Okay. When you informed me that you had been described or characterized as the laziest and most selfish person this person had ever met, and when you told me this proudly, I have tried to see you otherwise, but I have absolutely had very little evidence to the contrary.
So you're saying that no matter what Mr. Knight does, you're always going to see what he does as negative.
That's quite the opposite of what I said. I try to see good in you despite the lack of evidence.
So you believe there is no evidence that Mr. Knight is a good person?
That's not what I said. Your intentions being anything other than selfish and lazy, I don't see evidence of that.
You see everything that I do in a negative light simply because of an impression that you have got about me? Is that what I'm hearing?
That's not exactly. Your intentions appear. Your self-interest is obvious in just about everything that you do. I'd like to see otherwise, and I'd look for other. But no, I don't set out to view everything you do negatively.
You feel that your attempts at making things right, the way you want it, is more important than Mr. Knight's?
No.
You don't? Okay. So, if Mr. Knight gave you a gift out of kindness, how would you perceive that?
There's two elements to that question. If you gave me a gift, and you've given me three gifts in our entire relationship, out of kindness being the other part of that, I have yet to see a gift of kindness. I have seen three gifts out of self-interest.
Self-interest.
And I could elaborate.
It would be your opinion of my interests. So no, thank you.
You asked for my opinion, so.
Okay. Ms. Voss has put in a whole bunch of medical records from Mason Clinic that I was wanting to talk about, but I have individuals, and I was wondering how I'm going to get my stuff I would like to talk about, which is Exhibit 11 and 12, to coincide with what she has already put into this in a timely manner.
Well, it might be, so it'll be your 111 and 112?
It'd be my 111 and 112, yeah.
There are times where it is appropriate to admit documents that have otherwise been admitted to, for the purposes that you're just talking about. This case is full of exhibits that have compound evidence in them.
Right.
I'd like to keep that limited, but I also recognize that to try to pull these documents out of a larger document, unless you're prepared to do so, would be difficult.
Yeah, I wasn't really prepared to do that. I was expecting this type of 904 system.
And I can simplify with the cross-reference I have of 111 and 112 are both contained in Exhibit 55, which I believe is not huge. Mason General Hospital Office Clinic notes, 817 and 28. It's not a huge document in my recollection.
Well, if indeed it does not make it...
My concern, Mr. Knight, I did see them in there.
Yeah, my concern, Mr. Knight, is that by doing this, does it harm your ability to do what you want to do? That's what I'm getting to. So if we pulled up Exhibit 55 and you knew exactly what page to go to, that would work out just as well.
It works fine with me. I just need to. I don't know exactly, but I can find it. But it'll work for me.
Let's go to 55, please.
My 11 is the first three pages of 55.
Okay.
Okay. So, Ms. Voss, on Exhibit 55, the first three pages. Oh, sorry.
So does that mean you need to pull 55?
No, I'm just going to go off of this.
Okay.
Okay. The first documentation it should be Mason Clinic office clinic notes from 8/17/2020 at 16:39.
That's what I see.
Okay. Is this the follow-up visit from... the visit to the Seattle Children's.
Yes.
So, and everything, and this is whenever the doctor first just prescribed some recommended prescribing medications for Chloe?
Yes.
And we did not do.
I'm sorry.
Is that true?
To my understanding, this is the first record I've seen about that. I don't know if you've actually brought the children to other providers seeking this medication or not. So this is the first record I've seen.
Okay. So it would be proper to say that this is the first that it had been diagnosed, recommended?
Again. To my knowledge.
Okay. So what was the reason why we both had was reluctant to prescribe psychotropic drugs to our daughter?
And can you point me to where it states that?
Do you have, I'll change my question. Do you have reservations about Chloe taking
depression medications.
I have concerns.
Did you have concerns at this time?
I have general overarching concerns about the use of unnecessary medication for our children. That was our mediation agreement from 2014. Yes.
Okay. Was there any other reason why you could think of that we as parents may not want our daughter to take medications prescribed for antidepressant?
I can only speak for myself in motivation or concern. And so, again, any use of medication that is unnecessary, I would steer clear of. We were going a very natural route in terms of managing our children's health issues without medication. I believe any medication changes our body chemistry, and in this case, changing the brain chemistry of a young developing brain, I feel is, and as Dr. Langer testified, it is kind of a last resort sort of thing. I don't think we have exhausted or even attempted therapy that would be appropriately aligned to Rice's needs. Since Rice started self-harming in second grade, therapy has not been aimed at minimizing the symptoms and problems expressed.
Isn't it true that we did not have any medications prescribed for Chloe at that time?
I was not a decision maker, so you chose not to. I weighed in with my opinion.
Isn't it true that Mr. Knight asked your opinion on this subject?
You certainly did, right in front of a doctor, and it was well documented that you appeared to consider my opinion, yes.
So I had made a call from that office that day and spoke with you about what the doctor was contemplating on prescribing, did I not?
I can't remember who called who.
But over the phone, we had a conversation about the medication while the doctor was present, correct?
My recollection is I brought Rice to the appointment. I was in the parking lot. You told me to stay there as I asked to join in the appointment and that you might call me. And I think I might have called you, but I can't be certain on who called who. And yes, I did participate by telephone in the appointment with your facilitating that and your permission.
Okay, in 55 there. There's another one I would like to talk. It correlates to my 112. It is also a Mason Clinic, office clinic visit on 8/28/2020.
Which page is that?
I am not sure which page it is in that one there. I'll pull mine out if you'd like me to dig through and find it for you.
It is on page 13 of 27.
I see it. Thank you.
Is this the clinic note from the date you decided to take Chloe in and started have her checked for her bruises that you were concerned about?
As I previously testified, I didn't decide. I was instructed by the ask a nurse as to what exactly I needed to do. And so I was following her direction. And yes, I brought rice to Dr. Mallett at that direction.
And then you attended this appointment here, correct?
I did.
And you described in detail yourself to the provider of what had happened, correct?
I was not present during the incident, so no, I did not describe what happened. I described what Rice, the doctor asked Rice what happened, and Rice shut down and wasn't able to talk. And so I very slowly started the conversation with Rice, told me that something happened, and trying to get Rice to explain what happened. And asked Rice to show the doctor their wrist, and we kind of walked through very gently with both.
Can we classify that as coaching?
I wouldn't classify it as coaching. As I was trying to say, there was a doctor and another person present during this visit, and the doctor was asking questions, and when Rice wasn't answering, I was trying to ask them, you know, what happened here? What happened? Based on the information they shared in the car with the ask a nurse person, I shared that same information, trying to get Rice to explain more, to show and be seen based on what Rice had reported.
So you had control of the narrative from before you got there and after by talking to Rice, and then have to explain it to the doctor and assist Rice in this. Isn't it true you had control of the narrative?
No.
Okay. No further on that. So on that one. Ms. Voss, have you ever been diagnosed with obsessive compulsive disorder?
No.
You've never had any kind of indication that you may have OCD?
No.
It's 306 a.m. Ms. Voss's evaluation by Dr. McCollum.
I'm sorry, what was that?
Exhibit 306, it has been, I think that was the number. I'm not sure.
Double check.
It is. In my records, sorry.
Okay. And so what we're going to do before we get there, we can pull 306, but it's 3:30. So we're going to break until 3:45. I got word from court administration, they have now taken me out of the Tuesday docket and allowed me the opportunity to continue with this trial on Tuesday.
Okay, thank you, Your Honor.
Okay, so we will be starting up after break, but then we will also be going on Tuesday.